And, well, it out with an immediate surprise with a Fiora ban.
I mean, it's not that surprising when we take Warrior Lady into account. I have to say that.
I think, I'm sorry, most people are still going to be surprised.
No, let me dial that back a second. Let me dial that way back. Part of me was like, well, maybe they accidentally hit it. And I was like, it's not a surprise. No, Fiora is a massive surprise for those of you that aren't familiar with Warrior Lady.
I think I'm going to side with the viewers here.
I'll give most you that. Of these are very different bands. I mean, Syndra we saw banned in the last
the same band. Do we want to take a minute stress?
I need a minute. Because
Fiora, Syndra, and Lulu. So far, Sparta really mixing things up.
That's
different dimension,
me.
However. Laying things down to something we know a little bit more about. Thresh, though, is different again.
Yeah.
So here we go. Three of the six so far have changed. Comfortable.
Let's bring it back. I've still got the hype from last series. I'm just seeing crazy things, and I'm off on one. But now,
bright colours and flashy lights.
Yeah, exactly. Now it has to be the last band. There we go. Okay, good. Something is consistent in this pick and ban phase. So Lulu banned out, maybe as a top lane pick. Haven't seen it in too much of a time, but wow, Steve is going to lock in Irelia incredibly quickly.
Yeah, and I think that really surprises us too much, as we mentioned, how much of an impact Zaz has made with that in the last game, how strong she is, secondly only to Gnar, and how hard she is to deal with by any of the other possible top lane picks. So doing that doesn't reveal too much about their team, doesn't reveal too much about their strat, and gives them a great solid footing for that lane, which we've already mentioned and keep mentioning is such a big factor in the current meta of this 419 patch.
Yeah, we know that Steve is an Irelia player. It goes along with his strengths. His other preferred top laner right now is Kassadin. I have a couple of flex picks on Sparta, but now that we're into the picks phase, nothing is all that weird yet.
No.
Corki would make sense here.
A bit more familiar.
Probably a Lee Sin or a Jarvan when you look at it. Because I know that Sean's is not much of a Lee Sin player, so they could look to take something else away and force him on to an uncomfortable champion. But that isn't going to be the case as of yet.
No, they're opting to go with their solid bottom lane instead, and it gives Sean's an immediate jump onto that Jarvan. And again, very, very much like our previous best of three, Sona in that second round blue side pick. I think that was...
Yeah.
Every game in that first best of three, Sona came up in that second round blue side pick that she was selected.
So
that's, again, very much in the familiar. But the fact that Different Dimension waited on their jungler a little bit longer, there is the one jungler we didn't see in that last series that I want to see and could now be getting, is the Rengar. We didn't get that before.
We didn't get Rengar in the last series. And is it in Different Dimension's playbook? We know Rengar is a very decision-heavy champion. You have to pick your engages very carefully. You can't just go in. You have to balance all of your Fury charges there and make sure that you have five stacks when you look to engage. This would be the option that we saw out of top lane for our matchup against Irelia, and looks like it may indeed be the lock-in. Will we see an Orianna here alongside it?
Oh,
well, then.
Incredibly different.
Okay.
All right, this may be very much why Different Dimension waited on the jungle pick. That Maokai could be in the jungle now, but we've got an immediate follower from Sparta. They had their picks locked and knew exactly where they wanted. Sivir, Lissandra.
Yeah, and these are two champions which I really need to talk about a little bit. Sivir in the matchup against Corki, you spell shield off the Phosphorus Bomb and have an amazing amount of wave clear to be able to just completely push Corki out of lane. It makes for a very difficult siege time for Corki. Mid lane, this is a pick that Sparta pick from time to time. Schleyer can play it in the middle lane.
I was going
to
say, is this Sparta doing their research on DD and getting the pick ban phase predicted? Or is this a comp that Sparta run lots of the time and just know how it works perfectly and are that confident with it they can run it against any kind of picks?
Yeah, this is Sparta's kind of standard setup. They'll pick flex pick Lissandra if they need to, but Schleyer will pick Lissandra in the middle lane very comfortably blind, because that could potentially be what it's up against. And I guess, what is this? Maokai in the jungle? Malphite in the top lane?
I guess that would make sense. Malphite against Irelia we know very regularly, but again, he struggles later. Maokai can do the same thing, doesn't have as bad of a time later on, but is far weaker in the jungle than Maokai, especially pre-6.
Yeah. So, Zed was the final lock-in. Zed into Lissandra. Pre-6, well, it's a level 6 rush, because if Zed can obviously ult Lissandra before Lissandra has her ultimate available, where she can just ult herself and not take any damage from the death mark, that's a fairly easy lane to come out of. But you have to feel like Schleyer knew Zed was an option here. It was open from the picks and bans phase. It's a very highly contested pick.
Schleyer is a very confident player.
Yeah.
And he's very, very confident in his own abilities. If he wanted that Lissandra without having a mid laner already picked, without knowing what he's up against, he is incredibly confident that he can 1v1 down Mage Bane, regardless of what he picked, regardless of the champion. Now, of course, you've also got the likelihood of Shaun's coming in and helping as well to help him along. But if Schleyer picked Lissandra blind, Schleyer expects to win this matchup no matter what.
I am trying to wreck my brain to figure out when the last
still
time...
Got two best of threes left. I wouldn't wreck it yet.
No, okay. But I'm trying to remember when the last time we saw Maokai was. And maybe our viewers... Yeah, in the jungle. Sorry. We saw it many games, but in the jungle. Maybe our viewers could remind us.
So. I don't remember where we last saw it in the jungle. So at LOL Esports, please, and let us know. Or just use the hashtag EUL... Hashtag LCS expansion and get in contact with us there. And of course, crowdsource. If you don't know, have a look at the hashtag and wait for someone else to let you know, because it's been a good 2-3 months
since jungle.
Long before Worlds, since we saw Mac in the jungle.
Last time consistently saw him in the jungle, we're talking back way into season 3.
Oh, consistently, yes. Yeah. But there would have been one or two little sprinklings, but still, I mean, we've done a lot of Challenger stuff. We've watched every week of the LCS, and it's still good. Good 3-4 months? Long before Worlds, long before any kind of playoffs windows too. Someone's got to link a Leaguepedia page. Someone will get it in a minute.
Yeah, it'll be like last week in LPL or something.
it'll probably be some obscure Chinese or a Southeast Asian
obscure?
Game.
LPL?
No, I'm not saying LPL is obscure. I'm saying one of the lower ranked LPL teams. Shut up. Stop making me look bad.
It's okay.
Oh, dear.
Oh, I was going to say because we're headed into game.
Yes, but we're not quite.
Unfortunately,
into the game
we don't get saved by the game.
We do just have a quick pause as players. Make sure everyone loads in at the same time. Make sure no crazy advantage for that potato PCs that some of these players may or may not have.
You're just laying out the smack. LPL's
a thing. When have you been in a solo queue game where one guy doesn't take half an hour to 45 minutes to load in?
That's true. It's normally Pulse, to be honest.
Normally Pulse, that's very true. We've all been in games with Pulses. Pulse, do you want to play an Aerium? Yeah, sure. Do we have 3 hours to spare? And then he goes and plays things like Tank Teemo or AP Mundo. AP Mundo wasn't actually bad, actually. I can't give him too much flack for that. But hopefully it won't take too long for these guys to finish loading.
Dear.
We, of course, did see all the picks, so let's go back to this game. We've touched on Spartas. We've been over there. We've talked about how Schleyer loves his Lissandra, how they're very confident with the Sivir matchups in the bottom lane, especially against Corki. But what are we looking at for different dimension? They've got Maokai and Malphite. Those are two incredibly strong frontline tanks that don't particularly put out too much damage as the game gets to the late phase.
Yeah.
Zed can do, but he can also be shut down fairly easily. And with an exhaust, which actually Sparta don't have, he can be nullified pretty quickly. But at the same time, if you've got Lissandra autonomy, he can't do any damage in the first place. We do, in fact, get the pause up just before I manage to give each my point and ask the question. So we have opening up on this first game in this best of three between Sparta and Different Dimension. Sparta down in the blue side as your bottom left team and Different Dimension in the top right as the red squad. It'll be up in a moment.
There we go.
We saw it in the last couple of games. The level one strat was very, very passive. Nobody really gave much to sit back, just waited for each other. And again, it's what I'm getting from these guys.
Maybe we have a second to talk about the team comps now.
Yeah,
that might be a good spot.
I'm going to go ahead and say we have a full minute.
That would be a very well-educated guess. But Different Dimension over on our red side. What have they got set up here? You look at their team fight, as you kind of already alluded to, it has the makings of a good team fight composition, but the damage needs to follow up. And that was a problem that we really saw in our last series when they had the Malphite and the Jarvanon tricked, but didn't have an Orianna or something like that that had that massive follow-up damage to really take advantage. But I'm going to look at Anon Psycho's path through the jungle, how he's going to get aggressive in the early game, because we know Shaun's is a jungler that does like to be aggressive. And if you get caught out on a Maokai, that is a tough spot to come back from. The gold efficiency is not the same as if you're in lane on Maokai, so your items get pushed a little bit further back. But Vengeful Maelstrom will always be as potent.
I mean, we did mention before how Jarvan is not the best of 1v1 fighters, but when it comes to fighting a Maokai, he's more than enough. So we will see if Schwartz comes up against him or not. At the moment, like we saw in the last game, both bottom lane pairings were hiding in bushes getting that early kill damage. As it is, they were both waiting to be the first one to spread across. And it is Lunette that draws that first blood, getting a little bit of damage down onto Nami. But it's nothing too serious, as we do see them for that start that rush to level 2 that we're all so used to these days.
Yeah, the rush is on. And honestly, I feel like Sivir and Sona, going into this matchup, is potentially the better duo. You look at the sustain they have, the ability to reduce the damage that is being done by spell shielding that Phosphorus bomb off. Sparta's bottom lane right now could be in a great position to delay the mid-game spike that Dominant is going to have on Corki.
To be honest, the more I look at this Sparta comp, the more I like it.
Yeah.
With the move speeds buffs from Sona and from Sivir, it really is going to have a great time running you. Jarvan is going to have an amazing time closing the gap and getting an EQ combo off. They're just going to steamroll over different dimension if they get even the smallest idea of an advantage by just running at them.
That's what we've seen out of Sparta if you've had the chance to watch ranked 5's queue, though.
Let's look at the top lane matchup a little bit, because Malphite started a bit differently to the last time we saw Malphite versus Irelia. They were both Flask in the previous matchup. He has, however, this time gone for a cloth armor and seems to be doing a much better job.
Yeah, this is a much better start out of this Malphite side. This Warrior Lady, we already talked about, is one of the more known players here on different dimension, and we'll see whether he can actually get this game working, as Shawn's is headed up to this top lane to try and exploit him being pushed out. I don't think he actually crossed that ward as he's heading up here.
He certainly hasn't been spotted. Warrior Lady still playing very aggressive for someone that may know there's a giant gank in his path. We do see Steve flash forward. Now comes the knockout, but he's going to flash away from it. But Warrior Lady still taking a lot of damage. Jarvan flashes forward for the red buff slow, doing as much damage as he can, but Steve's still not close. And Warrior Lady is now under turret and safe.
Flash for flash, but Shawn's will take that. That's a successful gank up in that top lane. And Malphite, if he's going to push like that, has to be prepared for Shawn's to come top lane and help Steve out. We know that Sparta like to get Steve fed in the early game and then rely on Nono in the late game. And that just kind of works along with that synergy between Shawn's and Steve.
So both junglers were spotted in the rivers there. The pings were spammed right on their heads to make sure everyone knew where they were and make sure Slayer was safe from that Maokai roam too, because he is playing very aggressive and very pushed and trying to punish Magebane in what, you, as you mentioned, was that rush to level 6. So he has to be careful of where this Maokai is. Now that the flash is down, though, Warrior Lady's got to be playing even more careful. And as a result, she's coming around to place a ward in the Tri-Bush that has a Shawn's standing in it. So just about keeps us safe from this gank, forces Shawn's to back away without making too much of an impact. And to be honest, that's quite a bit of a problem for Sparta. Revealing where he is without doing anything about it or gaining anything from it, it's quite a bit of a win for different dimension at this stage in the game.
It is, but when you take into account the difference in play style between junglers, I think all that'll do is allow Anon Psycho to kind of breathe a sigh of relief that Shawn's isn't looking to invade on him, because Anon Psycho's just looking to farm up on this Maokai, and the early levels are not going to be very aggressive from him, so Shawn's is going to have a lot of freedom on this map. You can already see Anon Psycho has picked up that Quill Coat, which, of course, that's going to give him that extra ward coming out and give them more control of the enemy jungle. But Shawn's should be better off on the aggressive stance.
So we see the first shops coming out from both top laners now. Then Mana Crystal going in for Malphite, and Doran's Blade coming out for Irelia.
Yeah, so just having that extra bit of mana is going to help Warrior Lady as he gets pushed in here by Steve. But no major buys really yet. Nothing that is going to swing a lane all that much here.
Shawn's now is heading down bottom lane, finding a deep ward in by the blue buff, so now they're going to know if Anon Psycho is coming around behind that turret at any point. But the lane is a bit too pushed for him to really make any kind of gank down in that bottom lane just yet, unless he wants to come through the lane bushes himself. But they need to make sure they're clear of wards before he tries to do that. So he's going to go back to the golems first.
We spoke briefly about how this matchup was going somewhat well for Warrior Lady, but check out the CS difference right now. Steve is having his way up in this top lane, 45 CS to 27, and Warrior Lady just isn't able to trade. There's the 6.
Well, she can trade. She can do damage back whenever Steve goes in, but that doesn't mean she's getting CS. Warrior Lady's just slamming down his ability there from Steve comes on top, and for a little while, it was more damage. But now Steve has Adoran's Blade, and Warrior Lady is still trying to build defensive items. Steve is starting to grow that lead up. She's CSing far easier, and he's got much more sustain with that Crystalline Flask.
Yeah, with the Cloth Armor start, Warrior Lady actually doesn't have any sustain now that his health potions are gone, so he's kind of stuck here under this turret. Yes, he's got that little shield that's going to come from his passive, but until he's level 6, there's not really too much he can do here in this lane.
So, and on Psycho, where are you at? You're at level 4 to the level 5 of Shawn, so despite being in the jungle the whole time farming, you're farming slower, even though you're on the same CS. Does now hit that level 5 point, but still, it's a little way behind. Looking to see you make an impact somewhere soon. I do love Maokai jungle. It was a staple of my jungle repertoire for a while, but it fell out of the meta. So please, please show me how to bring it back, Anon Psycho. Make an impact. Do something in this game that makes Maokai worth a pick.
Who knows? Maybe on the updated Summoner's Rift with patch 4.20.
With all the fancy new items, one can dream.
One can dream, but Warrior Lady dropping quite low.
Very low, but Steve still knows he's not strong enough to go under turret, so does have to turn and back away as he uses up the last charge of his ultimate. That blue buff now actually was passed over to Zed, I believe, rather than Maokai taking it, which is odd if you're trying to rush Maokai to 6, but if you are having a tough time with Zed against Schleyer, you're going to need that buff instead. We do now see Sparta looking for an invade on this red now that they knew, because one, they had wards, two, they saw Zed leave to go to that blue, so they know jungler is not that side of the map. They know they had that kind of suspicion, had an opportunity. So Schleyer went in there to back up Shawn's, and they do manage to steal away that red.
Bottom lane, let's see how it is going for Sparta. 75 CS to 63 is a good lead, and take into account that Corki right now has that Sheen as opposed to a BF sword from Sivir. Sivir's damage is going to be so much higher right now in the lane because
Jarvan, sorry, is top. He's gone in onto Warrior Lady and used that Cataclysm, but Steve had no health to follow it up. Now Shawn's is in trouble because Anon Psycho's there, and First Blood goes over to Warrior Lady.
Really nice pickup there up in that top lane. That'll offset a little bit of the goal difference between the two, but it is still a massive difference in favor of Steve, who got himself out of that lane. Different Dimension can't really push from that, but it is an even game right now, even with the First Blood.
Steve went in to take a trade, took more damage than expected. In the bottom lane, the bubble hits onto Lune, does return with the Crescendo. Nona's doing as much damage as he can, but it's not enough to get through Wild Panda, but Dominant can't do the same as well. And Lune, just about survives, flashes away with the Summoner heal. They baited him forward, though the Ignite is ticking, but Nona didn't get the return on the Boomerang, and everyone swivels away, tails between their legs. With no HP.
Yeah, none at all, as Lunette managed to get himself away from that. And you talked about taking more damage than you were expecting to. That is exactly what happened with that Different Dimension there. They put a lot of burst damage down on to Lunette in that bottom lane, and I really don't think Sparta were expecting that. You look at the difference in items. Sivir, in general, should be coming out ahead over the prolonged trades, but they do have to watch out for that Phosphorus Bomb.
Corki's burst is incredibly strong in these early levels, especially once he's got that Sheen up. And we just saw how close exactly it is. But Schleyer's starting to get a fair bit of damage himself now too, clearing those waves out very, very quickly, which is very hard for Zed, of course, to then roam against it, which is what he so loves to do. But other than that, their CS numbers are very, very even. Yeah, seeing that Zhonya's come out first from Lissandra too will allow her to give that double invulnerability and protect against Zed ults. Sparta turning down and making a very quick decision to go in for this dragon. It was close for Mage Paint, but against the Smite, he didn't really stand much chance at that point. They knew that Maokai was miles away, thanks to the wards they had placed in his jungle.
Yeah, they also knew there was no fight about to kick off because of the top laners. Neither of them have their teleport available, so...
And Corki and Nami had just based as well.
Yeah, that was the other factor there, is nobody was really around to contest that, so Sparta will take that down and extend their lead to about 1,000 gold right now. Let's take a quick look at itemization. Sivir actually opting for the Avarice Blade after the BF Sword, so not really going towards one item to begin, but plenty of options here available. Have to think that possibly is that Static Shiv.
Yeah, especially how strong Sivir's Wave Clear becomes with that Ricochet Static Shiv, and to be honest, even just the damage boost that he comes from, being able to use that extra auto attack, being able to use Ricochet and reset that cooldown, get another shot in, really boosts it up and helps with her burst too, to be completely honest.
Speaking of burst, mid lane, Mage Bane hasn't yet put his damage down this game. We haven't really seen Mage Bane commit to anything, and he is up in CS, but you already mentioned, it's because Schleyer is pushing him in so much, he's not actually able to roam and can't get any kills in the 1v1 situation here. Had a little bit of movement around the lower side of the jungle, but Shawn's is struggling to get into the lane. And one thing we've actually heard about Shawn's is that his consistency is a little bit in question. Sometimes when he falls behind, he finds it very difficult to get back into a game. And being 0-1 down, we'll see whether they can force any kind of engages, but the warding is just too good right now from Different Dimension.
Yeah, he's trying to make his way in his lane, but whether they know it's warded or not, it is. But he is playing very deeply because of it. So he's making sure he waits the last possible second to reveal himself, and in fact doesn't reveal himself at all when they realize that there's just no way Corki or Nami are going to come close enough for him to catch that engage.
The other problem is that laning with Sivir, who kind of wants to push the wave all the time, there's not a lot else you can do on a Sivir when it comes to laying down harass. So just works out a little bit inefficient for Shawn's, who stuck around there, but Warrior Lady not finding the greatest of times up in this top lane, down by a lot of CS.
Yeah, she's struggling again, very low health and mana at this point, but the shield comes back up, so help her a little while. She's going to have that frozen heart complete soon, which should hopefully look after her for a tad longer. But Anon Psycho, yeah, he's passing that blue buff over to Zed again to help him put up with Schleyer's constant aggression as Schleyer goes to grab his own blue. Now, of course, remember what happened last time they did this. Red buff was stolen away by Shawn, so that timing is going to be up very, very soon for him, providing he cleared the camp, which I think he did. We'll see if Sparta do anything about it, because we also have the dragon coming back up again in about 3 minutes' time. So there's a bit of a decision to be made by Sparta on which one they want to prioritize, and my money will probably be on the dragon, as in fact Sparta get caught out on a recall in the bottom lane. The bubble's going to hit onto Nono, he's already used the spell shield. Crescendo only hits Wild Panda. Corki's doing so much damage and forces the flash from Nono as the ignite ticks down. Doesn't get a kill, but Sparta not paying attention when they recalled.
They weren't paying attention and didn't really pay attention to what you were spell shielding off there. The phosphorus bomb damage actually landed amongst a big amount of burst that came from not only the ebb and flow, but a follow-up from Corki too. But have they overstayed? Shawn's, it's not in range.
No,
oh.
But just by being there,
yeah,
was enough for Shawn's to scare away the combo of Dominant and Wild Panda.
But Shawn's is going to maybe think that that's not warded next time he crosses through. If he comes for a repeat gank...
Although they did turn around as soon as he walked in there, so he might pick up on the fact that there was a ward in there, he just didn't catch it.
That is possible. If Shawn's was paying attention.
Yeah.
Which I hope he is, because this is game one.
This is a very important game, so I would hope he's paying attention. There's the 2 minute dragon timer. So we will start seeing people base, buying, spending their gold. Zhonya's hourglass complete on Lissandra now, which is great for her. And we need to see, if possible, that. Ivory, what's it called? I've drawn a blank.
What are you trying to describe?
What is Zed building?
Blade of the Rune King.
Blade of the Rune King. There we go. We need to see, if possible, that Blade of the Rune King completed on Zed before the dragon fight breaks out for him to get a biggest possible spike in this fight.
Take a look at top lane, though. Here comes Schleyer.
There comes up the side. Round behind onto Warrior Lady. The burst goes down. That's what happens when you prioritize armor against a roaming Lissandra.
Really well worked. This is Sparta down to a T. Schleyer is just going to roam on Lissandra, get Steve fed through the early game, and make sure that they have a good platform to set up for a later game comp where, you know, Nono is going to start to be more effective in teamfights.
Nono finished that static shiv now straight after his BF sword too. So now that he's got the attack speed and the wave clear up, they're going to keep pushing Corki into that turret even harder. We'll look to see for something
from
Malkai.
Can he get this? This is a dying turret.
It does, and that cancels the teleport.
Not sure what Warrior Lady was looking for there.
Now, here's a question, because I don't actually know it. Now that that turret was killed as a cancel, what's the cooldown on Warrior Lady's teleport? Is that a full cooldown? Is it a half cooldown? Is it a TP to turret cooldown?
I'm pretty sure it's a TP to turret cooldown. I think.
Looking at the speed that's going down, I think you may be right.
Yeah, that was the other thing that I was thinking. It's there in my mind, and I'm looking at how fast that's ticking down. I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, I hope.
Someone will tell us. LOL Esports.
Someone will be sure, but yes.
Hashtag LCS expansion.
We don't know anything. Just tell us, please, Twitter. Please. Oh, no. It looks like Sparta are also about to grab themselves the bottom tier 1 turret as well. So that's 2 turrets in very quick succession, unless... Yes, Nami is enough of a force to scare Nono away while he's there on his own. But the dragon has respawned now. This time, different dimension are closer. Do they have the vision they need to come into this safely? Double warding over one side. They do see Sparta here. Got a ward on the dragon itself. But Sparta has started it off. PD coming in round one side, planting another ward. Sivir ult goes out as she tries to disengage, but Anon Psycho gets straight in on top of it. Now they blink forward, Schleyer straight on top of Dominant. He has to flash away. No casualties yet. The first one is Jarvan, then it's Lissandra. Down goes Nami in return, though, as Zed is finished off by Aurelia in the backside. Steve came down from the top lane very late, but is doing everything he can now to save Lune's life. It's three members of DD left up as two members of Sparta are running for their lives. One goes down, only Steve left standing. Can we get an ace at a different dimension? The slow comes out from Warrior Lady, and on Psycho is not close enough for a snare, and DD pull off a 4-for-2 fight.
Really nice engage there, as Sparta just couldn't really balance everything in that fight there. Crowd control and damage that was coming out from Nono as Sivir just really didn't land there. And really,
it's not finished. He wanted to come back in, flash over the wall with the snare, and Steve just threw his life away for a whole lot of nothing.
I mean, did he see Maokai and think, well, I can out-smite you with no smite?
I mean, the dragon does a lot of damage, but Psycho was never going to be low enough for him to kill.
Not too sure about that. That's the first time we've seen Steve make a mistake like that, and hopefully it won't become a running theme, because he is 3-1 now, and we've talked to a lot of people. Steve is one of the best players here on Sparta, so decision-making like that maybe tells you that Sparta are a little bit shaken by the beginning of this game.
Possibly, but they do immediately respond now by grabbing this turret in the middle lane, which is an even gold count now for them, despite losing that fight, despite losing that dragon. And we've already seen how low the bottom turret can be, so with what they've just done here and taking complete control of this this blue side jungle, they also grab that tower then there and actually get a gold lead despite losing that fight and steal away the blue buff. So here is something going to the experience of Sparta. Yes, they lost that fight. And maybe that is exactly why Steve did what he did, because he delayed the recalls by delaying the dragon, and that allowed the rest of his team to come out onto the map and grab two objectives and a blue buff in return.
So overall, the net gain does go to Sparta.
So if that was 100% intentional, if that was why, it did pay off dividends for him. If not, he's just very lucky.
Yeah. I think that's fair to say. Steve may have been let off the hook there on that one, but let's not count different dimension down on that one. Maybe they want to look to answer that, because mid lane turret is fairly low on the side of Sparta here. So different dimension are grouped as five. Steve is having to hoof it down from the top lane, but Sivir's wave clear alongside Lissandra's is just too strong right now, and they cannot push into Sparta.
Yeah. As they back up a little way, of course, Sparta defend that turret successfully, and there's no other objective left on the map other than towers. DD just have to back and wait for a while. Corki's got a big wave of creeps to deal with in the bottom lane, so he can begin that now. Zed's going to do a similar thing in the top lane. Of course, we've all seen how much Zed's, once they hit this Blade of the Ruined King and Brutalizer power spike, love to just sit in a side lane and split push. But honestly, right now, I think Steve is far too strong for Mage Bane to actually do that against.
Yeah, I honestly think the same thing. Steve has quite a lot of health on him right now with that Giant's Belt alongside the Trinity Force, so Sparta are looking to siege up a top tower fairly early on here. They've got to be careful that an engage doesn't come out from Warrior Lady, but Sparta
she
are pulling back.
Jorns, but he has to take over the wall now. Anon Psycho has been sped up. Can he get the Twisted Advance?
Yes.
Jorns flashes, but too late. Anon Psycho goes deep. Nami wave comes straight on out. First man down is Jarvan. Jorns is dead. Two-man ultimate unstoppable force, but a four-man crescendo comes
the
in
heals,
return.
Though.
There is so much health coming back. Nono will fall down. Irelia is the next to go, and Sparta are left with two men again, as DD have four people up to chase
them. Schleyer turn.
Schleyer wants to turn, and DD know he can turn. So they back on away and get out of there with their lives intact. But again, DD come out on top 3-for-1 this time.
And this is the rank 5 team that finished top on EU West in Sparta against different dimension, who are a Nordic East team. We've already talked about the expectations, perhaps, by the general community when it comes into events with Nordic East against EU West. But I think one thing we're quickly learning this weekend
is that what we to expect from the Nordic East teams is not what we are seeing from the Nordic East teams.
I just caught some action on your screen, was all of us panicking to try and find it on the map. Yeah, that is the story that really is starting to change. These Nordic East teams are looking a lot sharper than people are giving them credit for, and you have to feel that maybe the US teams came into this completely underestimating their opponents.
See, the Sparta team comp, as I mentioned, loves to just run at people, and run at people comps work best when the people they're running at are trying to run away. What DD are doing here is either being the ones to initiate and chasing, or when they're being run at, they just turn and fight them back. And with their fight, with their very strong team fight comp, that is coming out on top for them.
Yeah, and it'll come out on top again and again until Sparta decide to change things up a little bit. And actually,
Zed does manage to split push, as I mentioned, down in the bottom lane, grabs himself that turret. So that's the first one of the game for Different Dimension. And Sparta didn't seem to really care too much about it. Not going to do anything to stop him until he hits that tier 2 tower, in which case they send Irelia down. She does still have a teleport, though, so she can come back and join them should they need it. But minute and a half on Dragon, and she doesn't want to be in the bottom lane when that spots.
No, when Dragon comes up, it is pretty much imperative that all of the Different Dimension lineup and Sparta are ready for that. But look at how far Dominant is up on the map right now. He's at a very important part of the game. I guess people are probably going to get very sick of hearing this, but Corki now with that Trinity Force and Sorcerer's Shoes is important to note. That is the point at which you can really start to group as a team and actually lay down all of the damage from Corki. So expect Different Dimension to, you know, group up, look for those fights. Only a minute left on that Dragon, and see if anyone's coming up with anything interesting. Now that Sunfire Cape has been completed on Malphite, but apart from that, everything across the map is somewhat standard.
I was going to say, talking about Malphite, 4-1-4.
Yeah.
So despite having a shaky lane phase, a lot of the kills are going over to Warrior Lady, which is going to help a lot when it comes to making him that unstoppable force that Malphite loves to be. Well, that seems to be doing everything that DD need it to. Mage Bane is doing plenty of damage in these fights. Dominant is doing ridiculous amounts, and they keep things going this way. Yes, the gold count is very even. The objective count is actually slightly in Sparta's favor, but with the death timers getting longer and longer and longer, DD can keep winning the fights. Then they will catch up in objectives very, very quickly.
I mean,
in fact,
Sparta
might have catch Warrior Lady. They go over the wall, but can't quite get any more to lock him down. Don't want to chase it deeper into the enemy jungle.
Ooh, that was a little bit of a dangerous moment there for Schleyer as he went in. There's the ult.
They're going for Anon Psycho. The movement speed comes off, but he's so tanky, he just turns to fight them again. The ult comes out from Sona. It goes in onto Zed, who gets blown up by Sparta when he gets come out of the stun. First man down on Sparta is Sivir. Now they've got Maokai, but they're trading evenly backwards and forwards. Warrior Lady is so low, but Sparta have to turn and run because Dominant has finally joined the fight, and his rockets are doing so much. Slayer's been caught into Zonya's, but he will undoubtedly fall. Does manage to take down Warrior Lady with him, but Lune and Steve get out. This time it's 3-3.
The chase is on. The Wild Panda has a speed up for himself. Is he actually going to get in range? I don't think so. No. So Different Dimension are just managing to turn these team fights because they're layering their crowd control so much better than Sparta are spreading out. And you saw multiple people get hit by the crescendo, get hit by the unstoppable force there. And the difference now to the earlier game of the day we saw when Malphite and Jarvan were together was in this composition, even when Maokai is, you know, from this jungle role, his Vengeful Maelstrom is reducing so much of Sparta's damage that the follow-up from Corki and Zed is so much stronger than everything that Sparta are putting out right now. But Sparta, have they sensed the timing, perhaps?
They feel like they have. They are trying to rush it down. 7 kills to 12, and the gold lead is finally in DD's favor at 3,000. But if Sparta can pick this up, it's going to be incredibly hard for a minute from Zed. Just spotted that boomerang blade over the wall. They were checking it. They thought, you know what? This has been quiet. Mage Bane goes over. It's going to take a lot of attention from Sparta. Does use his ult to try and take down Steve. Unstoppable force comes in to help him out. They're gone. Maokai gets the Baron. Steve's now being focused down by DD. He's incredibly low. DD trying to back away. Schleyer's low as well. They're going to try and finish him off, but he will ult himself to stay alive. Dominant is so incredibly close. They need Corki to join this fight. He's there and he has the damage. Slayer has to flash away. Dominant flashes to follow him. Rocket gets one. Looking for Nono and Lune now. Nono's followed. Warrior Lady's low and Lune finishes him off. But Dominant and Psycho are chasing onto Lune. Valkyrie forward. Ace for DD.
What good decision making on DD to check that Baron pit. And a very risky call out from Sparta to try and get a Baron when, I'll be honest, a Desperation Baron wasn't even necessary from Sparta there. They weren't that far behind that was their only option. And they randomly decide to go for that as opposed to other objectives. It's the Baron, and now at least one turret going over to different dimension. And we are in for a treat of a series for our second of the day.
I can see why Sparta do so well on the ladder. You look at their comp. You get a small lead in the little ones of your lanes. Runner people. Easy win. Small lead. Runner people. Easy win. All right, we're falling a little way behind. What do we do? But at this point in the game, they probably don't have good Baron wards. They probably don't have good vision. And if we get there fast enough, they probably won't think about checking it because, nah, no one does Baron this early in rank 5.
Yeah.
So it probably works out for them. They probably get away with things like that. But with so much on the line and with this being a competitive environment, DD aren't letting things like that go to chance. They are checking these Baron pits. They aren't just turning and running or giving up those early advantages. They are fighting every fight. And it's working for them very, very well. And now Zed's back to split pushing again. And what did I mention about keeping winning fights and the objectives evening out? 3 turrets to 3. They've grabbed themselves a dragon off of that last one as well. So that's one turret, one dragon differentiating the two teams. And as a result, an 8,000 gold lead for DD.
And how does Sparta combat that? How do they stop Zed? Who can 1v1 a Zed right now who has 3 kills, 6 assists? Okay, Steve is pretty strong, but I have a feeling with the difference in CS and itemization right now that Zed may even just be able to take that fight. I don't think this is late enough.
They've got no one that can 1v1 Zed right now, to be honest. What they need to do, if they can, is exactly what we had from our last game. Every time Babuni overextended, they had multiple people collapse onto him. What they need is when Zed overextends, multiple people collapse onto him. But Zed's not overextending this time around. And DD, as the rest of them are strong enough that you send more than one person against him, they're just going to run at the rest of your team. And they can tower dive now. Maofei and Maokai easily tank towers.
Yeah, and the other thing about Zed overextending is when a Zed overextends, he just uses Living Shadow and just gets away.
It's very hard to lock him down.
He's far more difficult to lock down when he's split push mode than pretty much any other champion that likes to do it in the game. And take a look, we talked about Anon Psycho in Maokai in that jungle role. We thought perhaps he'd struggle. We thought his itemization would be.
Oh, speaking about overextending, Mage Bane is being caught out by Steve down in the bottom lane, using his ultimate to try and get out. Dances back and forth, Jarvan Cataclysms, but Mage Bane turns around. Can he get the slow? Not quite, but DD are pushing straight up mid. Oh, 2-man unstoppable, force hit Slayer, and no, it has to try and turn and run, but Dominant's coming for him. Steve's back up here. Slayer uses his second in bomb, but comes down after Reds anyway. And they're diving onto the inhibitor turret. Steve is incredibly low, and it's a double kill for Corki. And that's exactly what I just said. DD are now diving a tier 2 and an inhibitor turret.
They've made this a 1-for-3, and DD are going to take down middle inner and force the middle inhibitor turret. Nobody is here to defend this. They can face tank this all day long. The inhibitor is going to go down, and I almost can't believe I'm saying that Different Dimension are in a commanding lead against Sparta.
They're going to grab this inhibitor with ease. They're up by 11,000 gold, and they're going to go back and spend a massive amount of money. At least 1,600 on Maokai, 1,500 on Corki, 1,300 on Nami. And they're going to come back out even stronger than they already are. And I love that response. It's the perfect play. It's, oh, you sent 3 people to kill our 1 Zed player. Fine. Yeah. Here's an unstoppable force, run away from this one. And it hit both Nona and Slayer. They must have been right on the edges of that knockup radius. It was perfect placement from Warrior Lady.
Beautifully played. And we've been told the Sparta lineup can be inconsistent. When they get behind, it's a struggle for them to get back into games. And right now,
they are a very emotional lineup.
Yeah, and that's where we find ourselves, is that they are behind, and Shaun's has very quickly gone from being somewhat even on Jarvan to 2-5 right now, and his items are looking very bare bones for this stage into the game. We're 30 minutes in, and he's only got the Elder Lizard and the Aegis of the Legion alongside a Sightstone. That is not a great spot to be in. When you look on the other side, completed Locket of the Iron Solari, completed Ancient Golem, and a Giant's Belt on top of that.
Have a quick look at the vision on both of these two teams, because you can see a massive amount of wards down on the minimap, but what do they actually show either of these? When it comes to red wards for DD, not actually a whole lot. There's a lot up the middle lane and a lot around the dragon pit, but that's about it. Sparta do the entire side of their map covered with wards, but that is purely to keep themselves safe. They can't do anything aggressive with those. It's just to make sure that DD can't catch them by surprise.
The other thing it didn't really stop is the fact that DD have just taken a dragon. Now, at this point in the game, Sparta pushing out like that,
and
knowing
a top tier two turret.
Oh man, and a top tier two turret. These objectives are falling faster than we can keep track of as well. But
warrior lady.
Bottom lane.
Bad face check into two members of Sparta, but doesn't care. He's going to want to double force into it. Nono goes down. The ult comes out from Lune to try and keep the rest of DD back. Warrior lady does have to flash out from the tower, but Sean's EQ's into his death. He's the only member to fall for now. Dominant Valkyrie's in towards the turret. First invuln comes off for Slayer. Has got the second one, but can't use it in time. Worry Lady's being focused down by Nono, but still won't die as the Mickey
triple keeps kill.
Him up. Triple kill for Corki. Sparta Lune is there, and it's a Quadra. And all the while, Magebane is trying to fight Steve up top. Dancing from shadow to shadow, but Steve maybe coming out on top of this one. The rest of DV don't care. They've got Super Creeps in the middle lane. They're just going to push straight up to meet them. They're going to try and end this game right now. They've got way too many minions for DD to... for Sparta to handle. The first Nexus turret is focused down. The Nexus turret number two is finished off. The Nexus itself is exposed, and Different Dimension take game number one off Sparta.
What a game one. This has turned out to be a crazy day here at the EU LCS expansion tournament. We are having upsets in game one of series all day long. I just kind of hope that Different Dimension can carry this through.
I have no qualms saying I did not expect that. Sparta have so many on top of that. They have so many experienced players. They have so many faces and names we recognize.